Sorry,
Okay.
okay, this is. I give up. I'm ready.
Okay, go ahead, Rohit. You can start the webinar. Hi, and welcome, everyone. We're so excited today for this exclusive live session with author, columnist, entrepreneur, film producer Twinkle Khanna as we talk to her about her book, What's in Your Dabba? So it's awesome, the book. I am Sukirti Gupta. I'm the co-founder of Sipping Thoughts. Sipping Thoughts, Juggernaut, Kids Talk Press, and Gurgaon Moms are so excited to host this session today. Lunchbox, or as Mumbaikers call it, Dabba, has always been a fascination since our school days. But to realize that even movie stars go through what our talented guest calls Dabba envy is so, so interesting. What started as a social media challenge by Twinkle slowly turned into a cookbook with such amazing, delicious recipes for us to whip up so we don't, as she says, pakao our brains anymore. And some of them are so interesting that you have to try them out. We all know about Twinkle. She's a widely read columnist. She has established herself in the literary world through a satirical style of writing that drives a strong message back to her readers. She has won many, many awards. And Twinkle is also the founder and CEO of Tweak India, which is a digital media platform for the modern Indian woman. So a big, big welcome to Twinkle. We're so happy to have you with us today. And in
conversation
today with Twinkle is Upasana Luthra and Mansi Javeri. Upasana is the director of Gurgaon Moms, the largest women's community in NCR, and Mansi Javeri is the founder of Kids Talk Press. So ladies, take it away. We're so excited to bond over food, and I'm already getting hungry.
Thank
Who
you.
Who begins?
Thank you.
Okay.
Go ahead, Mansi.
Hey everyone, so just to get the ball rolling and just get everybody warmed up, we thought we'll start with a fun rapid fire. And this one I'm really nervous of because, when you have a wittier and the wittiest person rather on the other side, oh my God, I just want to like duck. Every time I'm interviewing her, I'm always nervous. So I'm just keeping fingers, legs, everything crossed to ensure that that the answers I know that the answers are going to be really good, but still, I'm just nervous. Always
well, after having kids, you should keep your legs crossed when you laugh, as all mothers know. So yeah, it's a good idea, but let's begin.
Yeah. Now everybody gets it why I'm nervous, right? She comes up with these one-liners and then you don't know how to come back as a host.
My phone
but Twinkle, it's always a pleasure.
One second. I think something, my phone is malfunctioning, but that's life. And I've thrown it under a bed sheet thinking that it will solve my problem.
After 9 months of quarantine, you have to get how to go live on Zoom, right?
Yeah. I think that's a necessity today, but yeah, I'm clearly failing. So that's a good start.
Okay. So beginning with the rapid fire and warming everyone up, One dish that describes your state of mind right now.
Scrambled eggs, because I'm clearly scrambling to get everything right at this point of time. So yeah, I would say scrambled eggs.
Okay, acting or cooking, the one you're better at?
Definitely acting there. I have three expressions. I can even with great difficulty pull off a fourth, but cooking, I can't really do anything. I've made one dish, noodles with salmon, and that was it. So yeah, I definitely acted.
Okay. Most underrated sabji or ingredient in your kitchen?
Parwal. My mother keeps insisting that we should all eat parwal. Every time I go to a house, there'll be fish curry and there'll be prawns, but she'll say, try the parwal. So yeah, I would say that is sort of underrated.
What's tougher, writing a book or talking about it?
Definitely talking about it. People who write tend to want to hide behind their desks. They don't, they are sort of I would say, almost misanthropes who don't really like interacting with other people, which is why they're building up all these universes. So yeah, definitely talking about a book. But I didn't write this book. I just, you know, commissioned it. This was my wonderful Tweak team that put this together, and Varnika. So I can talk about this happily. Yeah.
Okay. One sabji you can't get Twinkle to eat.
One sabji you can't get me to eat. I can eat everything. I mean, I can, yeah. I can even, not only a sabzi, I can eat anything. If it moves and I can kill it, I can eat it. No problem.
Okay. Your reaction when you plan the meals and everyone frowns when they know what's for dinner?
So for some reason, I think women's liberation has brought me to a point where I keep wondering and complaining that why is this my job? But it still hasn't elevated me to a point where I stop doing it. So yes, I feel responsible, and I'll try and do my best to make sure that they are happy. But why is this my job is still something that I question again and again.
Right. You said in one of your interviews that Akshay is very good at cooking. He knows how to fry your brains, boil your blood. What's the one thing you guys fight about the most as far as food and family meals are concerned?
I think it comes partly from him being Punjabi and me being partly Gujarati. So Punjabis need to have enough food on the table to feed half of Chandigarh. That's, you know, the way they've grown up. I'm half Gujarati. So for me, one vati of dal and one vati of sabzi is enough. So we quarrel about quantities of food. And I remember a time when I started bugging him because he was eating too many avocados. So I said, do you know how expensive avocados are? And I think he lost it. He said, do you think Shah Rukh Khan's wife tells him...
Gujarati.
That's Gujarati, right? So he said, do you think she talks to him about the price of tomatoes and all that? I said, I don't know. And as I see them talking about carpets and curtains, maybe they talk about vegetables. Who knows? So I think that was one point. Right. Yeah, this avocado is a bone of contention.
Wow. And even when it's Akshay Kumar and Twinkle Khanna's household, the prices of avocado matter.
I think that if you are somebody who is living a life that is slightly grounded, or at least trying to have a life that's grounded as much as you can within your circumstances, then it's important to have a balanced viewpoint about everything.
Absolutely.
And I want to raise my kids in that manner as well. I don't think that, yes, of course we can buy avocados, but I mean, why waste anything is what I feel.
Right. Absolutely. And we have some really interesting questions from Upasana. So Upasana, over to you.
Thank you so much, Mansi. Hi, Twinkle. I'm Upasana. Hi. And I'm from Gurgaon Moms. It's such a delight to be hosting you today.
Thank you.
So my first quiz question to you is, from fiction to a book about food, in a world that's gone totally online with webinars, Instagram videos, and YouTube videos, what prompted this very beautiful recipe book?
A lot of people will tell you that they commission or publish recipe books because of the interest in food. And I would tell you that it's because of my complete disinterest in food. So I'm someone who can live on an omelette every day, but I have a family to please. So it started off with this desperation of finding new things to fill in their different boxes. And I started asking people online, you know, people started giving me recipes. So it began with that notion. And then the lockdown happened. And I realized that food, whether we can share a meal over a table or share recipes, is a way that connects all of us. And this idea of a book germinated. So I don't think, I mean, it's like saying that, oh, in a world of streaming platforms, why are you reading a book? It's the same principle. It's a way of communicating. It's just a different way of communicating. But the essence, the message is the same. We connect through food. We like to talk about it. I know so many women who, out of necessity or out of a need to escape, were calling up their mothers and aunts and saying, what's a recipe for this? And how much jeera should I add to that? So it's always been a way of connecting people. And I thought that putting it together in a book, all the recipes that people were sharing online, was an interesting idea.
It is indeed. And it's really been put together beautifully, the pictures and the measurements and all, which is, I think, something that's really important. Twinkle, as a mom, what is the one thing you pack in your children's dabbas, the one thing they can't get enough of?
So I think that I try to put in some of these vegetable tikkis and disguise them and make them look appetizing, I probably fail because those come back, you know, untouched. Aloo parathas, cheese sandwiches, I'm one of those moms. I don't think that I fuss as much as other moms do. But if they're getting a couple of green vegetables and, you know, some fruits, I'm fine. I'm also more concerned about what I'm putting inside their head as much as I am about what I'm putting inside their stomachs. So as long as I'm filling both adequately with the right stuff, I'm not really going to overthink about feeding them, you know, all the exotic vegetables of the universe.
That's lovely. That's a great attitude to have. So I see a lot of interesting recipes in this book, like there's a thepla pizza, and I actually baked your sister-in-law's cake today, the rum cake.
Oh my God, that's amazing. How was it? Did you like it?
It's delicious, Twinkle. I snuck away these pieces and kept it in my room. So that
how much rum did you put in it?
I was very good. I only put quarter cup.
Okay.
I didn't cheat on that part at all. But
I think you should have. It would be fun. And maybe then you'd be on this around webinar drunk and we'd be all...
That would have been really fun though. And then there's this very lovely zero waste bread. So what's your most favorite recipe that you tried from what's in
so
your
diet? So I tried the noodles. So this is the one I want to try because I love coffee and I really don't know what else to do with jackfruit. So these sliders are something that I want to try. But I did try making, and if I can do it, anybody can, Gauri Devi Dayal's noodles with salmon. Here it is. And my kids ate it, so that's a miracle. And it also is a small piece of validation that I'm going to hold on to. Yeah. So I tried this one out. Yeah.
I think kids...
And it was fun.
Taste test. Any kid. What has been your pandemic discovery, Twinkle? Has it been an ingredient or a craving that you've had for something?
I don't really have many cravings. The only thing I've ever craved for was peanut chikki, and that was when I was pregnant.
Okay.
So that was pretty much it. I don't think that I had any, like I said, I was just trying to make sure that everybody was fed and satisfied during the pandemic, and that was my job. I don't think I had time really to set my cravings.
Great, that's great. Because you've been hearing about people experimenting and dying to eat things like pani puri and making samosas at home. So I was wondering if there was something you made like that.
No, so my son was busy cooking and he was making us all these fancy desserts. And, you know, every day he was in the kitchen. So we did have a little bit of that. Both my men were in the kitchen, which was nice. And yeah, I think we should train our boys to cook. And if there's another pandemic, I hope it doesn't happen. At least then we can shove them in the kitchen and say, you know what, now you take care of this while I go and do something slightly more interesting.
I so agree on that. Definitely on the point on training our boys. Definitely so. So Twinkle, they say food arouses memories with its fragrance and presentation. What is your favorite food memory?
I think it's my grandmother's khichra because it's a dish that was, it's a family recipe and she would make it outdoors on a sigri. And you have to put different sorts of wheat and barley and meat and keep, and it's you have to probably stir the pot the entire day.
Wow.
And that is something that even today, if my mom makes it, it's not as good as my grandmother's, but when she sends it over, it's still something that evokes this nostalgia.
That's just such a beautiful thing about food, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
What's your comfort food, Twinkle? What's the one meal you have when you like come back after traveling?
So if I've worked really hard and I'm really stressed, and if I've definitely been on camera, which I find very stressful, then I want to eat a chocolate.
Okay.
And yeah, so I come back and I'd be like the whole day, I'd probably not eat as much. I'd live on water and coffee and a sandwich, and then I'll come back and eat a chocolate. So yeah, that's my comfort food.
Lovely, that's lovely. We have two of our members here who are going to ask you a quick question. So I'll take Shubha Ram first. Shubha?
Okay.
your question.
Hi, Twinkle. Lovely to meet you. And thank you for this evening. Lovely evening. My question to you is, in our community, Gurgaon moms, we have about 36,000 plus moms. And every other day, we have been seeing posts since the lockdown and even now as, you know, moms sharing how exhausted they are emotionally, mentally, physically, because, you know, everybody is at home, working from home. So what is your advice to them?
My advice to them is to tell everyone to fend for themselves after a point. You can't be, you know, find your own bloody socks and go and get something from the kitchen. And don't even call me mom, you know, just call me Tina auntie, maybe, so that I just am, you know, I can pretend that I have none of this baggage around me. No, but on a serious note, it's also a time to make them more independent. I think Indian moms, by and large, we make our children very dependent on us. We have this habit of doing everything for them. And I think this has been a period where we've had really to learn that they need to be pushed out and fend for themselves and do things for themselves. And I think that's very important.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Shubha. Anshu, your question.
Hi, Twinkle. Congratulations on your book. My question is, Tweak India is a very unique name. So what was the thought behind this name?
I think for me, it was primarily because I didn't think we were inventing a wheel. We're not the first digital platform, but we're definitely tweaking the wheel. We're giving you something that doesn't completely exist in this form, where you get a lot of information, you get a lot of advice, you get a lot of knowledge, but in an irreverent manner, and nobody is giving you a sermon. Hopefully we make you laugh sometimes while also giving you a new perspective on things. So we're just tweaking what already exists, and that's why it's Tweak India.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Lovely. Thank you, ladies. Thank you so much. That was really lovely, Twinkle. Lovely talking to you.
Thank you. And enjoy your rum cake.
Yes, I will. I really will. And it's a winner, that recipe. I'm so going to make it again because everything in it is healthy. Like, you can't go wrong with that. So do thank your sister-in-law as well for that lovely recipe. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Over to you, Meeta and Sukirti.
So yes, Twinkle, a lot of questions have come in for you. I'll ask the first one from Surbhi. Surbhi, go ahead. Please ask your question.
Hi, it's been a pleasure listening to the entire conversation. Twinkle, what I would want to ask you is about the books, the way you write them. So you touch such a chord with all of us in the books. Is it more about the observation skill, or is it so much more about the lived experiences you have when you write?
I think I'm watching everything all the time. It's just something that's inherently part of my nature. I had an accident recently and I was being put into a car to be taken to the hospital, and I could still see this woman, and I was watching her. She was on the other side. I could see she was wearing a neelam on her finger. She had a smile that didn't reach her eyes. She was trying really hard to be nice to the policeman. So these are things that my brain is constantly picking up, the way people speak and look and behave, even when I'm not paying attention. So I suppose it comes from that. And I think the one thing that does get better with your age, as your, I guess, skin falls apart and your body starts expanding horizontally, is your mind. So I think that the older you get, and like you said, the more you live, you have a wider perspective to write from. So I think underneath all the trappings, human beings are the same. So it's not difficult to find common threads between all of us. And I try hard to do that.
Wow. Thank you. So nice. So nice. I think your skin is glowing. So I don't know if the skin is hot.
But I hope so. But yeah, I know middle age has hit my backside, at least, if not my face.
Yeah. Tina, your question, please.
Hi, Twinkle. I'm such a huge fan, and we've been talking about food all evening today. But considering you're so fit, my question to you today is, what all do you eat on a normal day, and what would your cheat meal look like?
So, well, I don't know what a normal day is, but today I had 2 cups of coffee, toast and an omelette, because that was the easiest thing I could whip up. And my cheat meal, I don't know, mango ice cream, I think, would be my cheat meal. It's something that when I was very young in my family, we used to make mango ice cream, but we used to set it in those ice trays. So I grew up counting ice cream in cubes and not scoops. So that always is something that I go back to. So mango ice cream is my comfort meal, I would say, or food rather.
Awesome, awesome. Great, Mansi. I know you also had a lot of questions that came in from your readers.
Right. Thank you, Sukirti. Twinkle, one of our food editors at Kids Talk Press has asked this question, which is, food is associated with a lot of fear when our kids are younger. Our dinner table conversations are more about, you know, a separate meal for parents. You know, I'm on a diet, I'm on all of these fat diets. This is low carb, this is high protein. And conversations like this, and I remember you know, in one of your interviews, you said that for the longest time, to ensure that your kids eat right, you don't add up that fingers on this monk lady who wore French fries, and he never ate French fries after. So how do you instill the fear of, you know, how do you get rid of that fear of food from children?
No, I didn't tell him that the mutton lady chops his fingers so that he doesn't eat French fries. I was just playing a prank. I was just scaring him for the sake of it. I do that often enough, much to my husband's horror. But I think that instilling a healthy relationship with food in your child also comes about from when they look at you. I don't think that I have the healthiest relationship with food, at least not while I was growing up. But when I look at my daughter and I think with her, I've never told her, finish your plate, this needs to be done. I've always asked her, talk to your tummy, is it full, is it empty? It's a very simple thing, but she seems to have a healthy relationship with food. Also, I don't know whether these things, some of this I think is partly genetic. You're born either like a large eater who enjoys food, or you're born with someone who has a small appetite. I don't think that that is something you can train beyond a point. You can definitely streamline it, but I don't think you can irrevocably, you know, remove it or change it.
Right. And coming to your, you know, you've always spoken about your perpetual battle with weight. And like I said, with parents, you know, we either threaten our children, ke khalo warna, you know, police will catch you, or, you know, eat this is healthy. And we kind of label the foods that we feed our children, right? So how do you go about ensuring that you're not labeling or typecasting foods, because that's the language that they're growing up with?
I mean, I definitely do label food in terms of healthy and a treat. And but nothing is banned from the household. So it's not like you can't eat a chocolate or you can't eat ice cream or you can't, but definitely it's an indulgence and you can have it, you know, once in 3 days or once a week, or, you know, we definitely order in a pizza once in a while. So I don't think that there are any labels about this being terribly wrong and you can't touch it and this being healthy. A balance is all that we can really try for, and that's what I strive to do.
Awesome. Sukirti, over to you.
I know we're getting a couple of questions, and I think I'll take one of them. I think a lot of people want to know, what inspires you when you say, okay, this is the idea, or this is the book that I'm going to write, especially a book like this, which is very different. When you said, okay, you know, what inspired you to say, I think right now it's time for a book on food?
That's what I just explained, that this happened during, it started before the lockdown because of my own inability to, you know, cook and to have recipes and to have this whole repertoire of things to put into their tiffin boxes. And so it came about from that idea of me not being able to put it together myself and asking other people for help. And I realized that there must be a lot of people like me who need ideas and who need recipes and who need new things to fill, you know, their meal plans. And that's pretty much the idea behind what's in your dabba.
Awesome. That's amazing. I mean, I think I'm actually looking forward to trying quite a few recipes here, because some of them, especially the tikkis, are inspiring me the most. So, Amita, over to you, I think, to... Amita, you're on mute.
Hi, Twinkle. So I am a co-partner in Sipping Thoughts, and I've been listening to you. More than anything, your voice has a very, very calming effect. I don't know, many people must have told you that
And I hate my voice, so thank you very much. I'm always bugged about my voice. I don't like the way it sounds, but yeah, you made my day.
Do you have a question about the voice or the name?
The voice. The voice. So yeah, it has a... So Twinkle, I have a last question. I've always felt guilty. I've been a busy working mom and always felt that I'm a bad mom because I don't cook. I don't like cooking. So this guilt, how do you overcome it? Like, what is that piece of advice? There will be many more like me.
I mean, are you doing other things? Are you giving them love, confidence, bolstering their self-esteem, making them feel that they are absolutely wonderful? And also sort of giving, praising them, because a lot of times we're just correcting our kids, but are we praising them really for the attributes that are their strengths and making them feel that this is something that they can achieve and do and are great at? Then I think that is a job, that is a mother's primary job or a parent's job. Feeding is just, a very small component of that. I think it's making them into rounded people. And if you're doing that, then I don't think you have anything to feel guilty about.
Thank you, because that is something I needed as reaffirmation and the confirmation that yes, I am not doing a bad job.
My mother never cooked for me, and I don't think I did so badly for myself. So yeah, I don't think that I ever felt that she's a bad mom because she didn't cook. There were so many other things that she could give me in terms of, you know, even ideals and goals. And a working mother is a great example for a child to know that, you know, in every way, in terms of gender roles, in terms of ambition. So I think if you're a working mom and you can't cook and you're doing everything else, there's nothing to feel guilty about.
Thank you. I'll go back and at least talk about it to my children. And I know time is short, and you're talking about your mom's food. So I used to go to my mom and I used to tell her that I have not come to meet you. I've come to eat your food. So I'm a bad daughter, but this is what I so food and your mom. And I think that is the connection. And Palwal Sabzi, my mom cooks very well. So,
oh my God, okay.
Yeah. So I know we want to carry on for a long time. You all are laughing at me. I know Parwal is a real sabzi, but it is a tasty sabzi also. So maybe I can give my recipe to your blog next time. I think time is, we are not keeping you for long. And thank you for having being with us here. And
thank you.
I must buy that book because that is something we are struggling with every day. And so we thank Juggernaut, we thank Kidstop Press, and we thank Gurgaon Moms. Thank you, all of you, and having you is amazing.
Thank you very much for having me.
That was a lovely conversation, Twinkle.
Thank you. It was wonderful. Thank you. You made it really comfortable. Thank you.
Yes. Whoever's logged in, don't forget to get the book. Very important.
I don't think they can do without it now, because this book looks like I was reading the recipes, and you know that it is a quick fix that you must have it with you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And if I can make those noodles, anyone can, trust me. Because, I didn't even know that noodles will soak and the entire bit will go into the water. I kept saying, what about the top part, which is sticking out? Really, if I can do it, anyone can.
Thank you. That's amazing.
With that,
thank you very much.
And we wish everyone a very, very good night. And do try the recipes. They are actually very easy. And look forward to you writing back to us or putting it on Instagram. So do share your thoughts. Good night, everyone. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you,
Twinkle.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Twinkle.